Hello, hello, everybody. It is 4:01 p.m. Central Time on Tuesday, the 11th of July, 2017. Welcome in here to the Earthquake 3D live stream, where we daily recap seismic events from around the planet. And we also issue semi-daily and weekly earthquake forecasts for new areas to watch for movement. In case you're new here, and I do this every day, you don't know what you're looking at. We're looking at roughly the last 48 hours worth of earthquakes reported from the USGS, EMSC, and GeoNet. And if you're not familiar with the program that I'm using, let me just quickly show you something here. You can download a free copy of Earthquake 3D so you can keep track. I don't get anything for recommending this, guys, so there's a free version and a paid version. The paid version allows you to select multiple feeds, and this is the stock version of Earthquake 3D. And I'm using the USGS 7-day feed, the EMSC world feed, and the GeoNet down in New Zealand so we can get a good picture. So you're welcome to download a copy and follow along and keep track of the earthquakes that strike. And of course, last night was a significant night down here in the Southwest Pacific. And let's get into the earthquakes that struck since yesterday at 4 p.m. Last night, there was that 6.3, 6.8 actually is where it started out. They took it down to 6.6 to 6.3, striking south of New Zealand. And within the hour, a 5.0 earthquake showed up here at the central part of New Zealand right now, where we have a 4.3 and 4.1. Well, a 4.9 showed up there, and we made a report on it. Of course, it popped up on the feed, and we talked about it. It was on for about an hour. Hour and a half, and then they took it down and issued a public apology over on their Facebook page, saying that their equipment malfunctioned and detected a 4.9 as a result of the 6.4 down to the south. They removed that earthquake, and of course, whenever they remove an earthquake, we talk about it and, of course, try to figure out why they removed it. In this case, it's a good explanation. I will accept that 4.9 was most likely a cause of the 6.3 down to the south. But to follow that up today, as if we needed any more signs that something was going on, the earthquake we were looking for, the mid-range 4, struck two different events. 4.1, let me open up the screen so you can see that here. Actually 4.2, but downgraded to 4.1. And a 4.3, reported by the USGS. And here's the other report from it, from the EMSC. So again, you know, you talk about it, the earthquakes that are striking there. The earthquake that is striking there, 4.3, is the one we're expecting to hit as a result of the deep earthquakes up to the north. So, regardless of whether or not the 4.9 happened or didn't happen, today we have a new 4 striking right in the middle as expected. Again, exactly as expected. So we go around the plate. Let's talk about the other earthquakes that hit as expected. How about a 5.0 up here at Hokkaido in Japan? Here's the island of Hokkaido. Here is the earthquake. So definitely close enough, and magnitude-wise, spot on in the magnitude. We try to get it down to the magnitude range and the location within 200 miles. Well, this is definitely within 200 miles of Hokkaido. So there we go. All right, 5.0 striking on the north part of Japan, but it's deep. It's 340 kilometers deep. Well, a deep earthquake can cause a shallower, larger earthquake. So not only do we get an earthquake forecast hit, in other words, the location we were looking for with the magnitude struck, but it's also a deep earthquake, which means itself is going to cause a new 6.0 to 7.0, somewhere between that range, 6 to 7, striking next to the deep earthquake. Now, in the silent zone next to the deep earthquake. Well, there's only a couple spots to look. Both spots should move. So if we're looking at this, we, of course, go into a silent zone in between Hokkaido and Kamchatka, Russia, where all of the eruptions are happening. Then you go to the south, and you have another zone in between the 5.2 here and the 5.0. So the halfway point between the 5.2 and the 5.0 brings us in on the coast of Honshu. The other halfway point brings us in here just south of Kamchatka in the Kuril Islands. Both are going to move on both sides of this 5. Additionally, whenever we see deep earthquakes here, pressure is also exerted across Mongolia and China going down to Nepal. We've seen deep earthquakes up here before in the 5 range just a couple days before the big earthquake in Nepal. You may remember back when Nepal got creamed with the big earthquake, like 1 or 2 days before, I think it was 2 days before, 2 days before there was a deep earthquake that struck here in the Sea of Okhotsk. And then that was followed 2 days later by the big earthquake down here in Nepal. Now, I'm not saying that's going to happen again, but we do have to watch over to the west of this 5.0. So three directions are really going to move to the south, to the north, and to the west. And that'll all happen in the next few days. It won't even take that long, okay? So now looking over across the rest of the plate, we go all the way past Indonesia, and we get over into Europe. So since yesterday, no new activity to report to us of any significant size across Asia and the Middle East. Stopped. So yesterday's 4.1, last night's 4.1, that's it. But look what happened today in Europe. Well, the Crete 4.0 last night, let's get that off the feed there. There's the 4.0 from Crete last night. Today, up at the Czech Republic with border with Germany, a new swarm up in North Europe, right along the Craton edge, just south of our red arrow. So a new swarm happening there. Well, I would say pressure has come up out of Macedonia and followed the arrow around to the east and up to the north. By the way, this is right next to where that 4.5 mystery earthquake showed up just a day ago. Right here at the Holland border. Right here at the Holland border. At the center with, the ocean or England. And so there's a 4.5 there. Now we have a swarm, a very rare swarm, happening in the Czech Republic. Now, I haven't looked up the location. I don't know what's there. There might be something of significance at the location. Should we go check together? Let's do that. Let's quickly put in the coordinates, just see if there's anything there before we go over into the United States earthquake activity. Whoops. There we go. So let's just see what's there. Might be nothing there. Might be something there. Don't know. Nothing. A field. Okay, we'll back this out ever so slightly. Have anything nearby? Oh, well, I'll be. We have a giant strip mine. Giant strip mine. Don't know what they're mining there, though. Don't have a description on that. What's the depth on these? Hold on. 10 kilometers depth? Auto-generated depth? Is that for all of them? Well. We might have found ourselves a volcanic area where they're mining out. And that would make sense if you look at the mountain range. Now, I don't have anything marked here, no volcanic fields, but then again, there's nothing marked for the whole country, so I'm not shocked that they might not have something listed there. Doesn't mean there's nothing there, but they're doing mining, which usually is, if you get something in here, there's usually something precious that they're trying to get to. It's not a clay mine from the looks of it here. Maybe coal. All right, well, if you guys can find out any information on that, it's close enough to be related to it, but not directly tied to it. In other words, that what they're mining there might be related to why the earthquake is striking there. Backing it out, I see a greater shape in the craton here that kind of, it's like a circular shape here. Hold on a second. What the heck? Hold on. Let's turn off our borders and labels really quick. Am I just, this might be pareidolia, like where you want to see something that might not be there, but just looking at this, hold on, we're at 900 feet on the western side, and then we go up to the center, which is 1,400 feet, and then we come back down to 700 to 900 feet on the other side. What's it up to the north? 900 feet to the north? Hold on. And 1,000 feet to the south. 900 feet all around, and then it rises up at the center to 1,400 feet. It's a dome. No way. Hold on. Maybe somebody's already studied this. It's a dome. There's no doubt about it. Look at it. I can't believe it. How did I miss this? It's a dome shape in the craton. Look at it. Now it's obvious. Oh my God. Okay, well, on the edge of the dome shape making up the entire country of Czech Republic. With Prague right at the center at the top. Wow, okay. Well, maybe somebody's already studied that. I have no idea. Maybe somebody has already studied that. Anyways, on the western edge of that, that's pretty interesting. Yeah, that's like the one up in Canada. It looks like the one up in Canada. You guys remember the one up in Canada? Here, let's show it to you. We'll show it to you. It's huge. Let's bring it back. Okay, starting up here in northeast Canada, right here, you can see the lake takes the shape of it on the northern end. It's kind of hard to see it. There you go. You can kind of see it here. And then down to the south, going down into, I guess, north. Is that Saskatchewan? Here's another one right here. So you can see it here. And it's a dome. It does the same thing. It's like 800 to 900 feet on one side and on the other. On all sides, it's 800 to 900 feet. And then it rises up to the center to 1,400 feet. And the other one is all the way up here in northern Canada, right here. But you have to look real close to see it. It's an oval-shaped dome. Goes all the way down here. You can make out the northern side, and it does the same thing. It's lower on all sides, and then it rises up to the center with a direct dome. There's another one over here in Russia that's absolutely massive that we found. Sorry, I'm getting sidetracked on this, but I just have to talk about it. It makes up pretty much all of Siberia right here. You can see the crescent-shaped lake down to the south, defining the southern tip of it, and then it goes all the way up here, and it has a northern part right here. And then it rises, believe it or not, it rises on the northern side here, and it dips on the southern side. So this side is higher, this side is the depression. But it definitely is. But it's huge. It makes up, I mean, you almost have to be up in space to see how big it is. Okay, so anyways, interesting. That's really interesting to me to see that earthquake striking there. Now, let's get over. Oh, that's it for the earthquake activity in Europe since yesterday. Only a few earthquakes striking to the north. Look at Italy. Just zeros and ones to report in Italy. We'll talk about what to look for in a second, but I want to talk about the rest of the earthquakes that hit today. Look in South America. You can check off the Ecuador-Colombia border if you were looking for locations that we named. We named the area at the north tip of the red arrow. See this big red arrow? We told everybody to watch at the tip of it today for a mid-range 5 to strike. Now, that was based upon the deep earthquake over here, the deep 4.6. We said it could go up to 5.6. And there it is, 5.3. So 5.3, just a couple, literally 0.3 off from what we were looking for and right at the Ecuador-Colombia border. So check that one off the list. Down to the south, we have not seen our new 5 yet. The only one we had was the 5.6 a day ago, which they downgraded to 5.2, 5.3, by the way. So 5.3 to the south, 5.3 to the north. Anybody shocked? But we should see this impact down here pretty soon in the next day and a half, 2 days. So the north part has been hit. South part will be hit. So let's get us into the United States. Look at what hit in the U.S. since yesterday, guys. Now to see what's going on, I'm actually going to have to turn on the NR Canada feed. So this is the Natural Resources of Canada site showing us the Canadian earthquakes. And what you're going to see up here, again in the last day, is a new 3.3 reported by the Canadians. USGS choosing to do some funny business with that and not report the 3.3. So again, they didn't report it. But now, guys, we issued a warning for a 3.0 earthquake to strike at the New York border, and look where it is. So let's get our coordinates on this just so you can see. Again, we're getting the information from Canada itself, so it's definitely trustworthy. And here we go, 3.3. Let's get the coordinates on this. Put them in on Google Earth to show you it's falling inside the continental United States. So there's no reason the USGS should not have this earthquake on there, at least at the magnitude that's being reported by the other agency. Now check it out. Look. Okay, here. Now I'm going to turn on our borders and labels. The yellow line is the U.S. border. So we are on New York side of the border, 3.3, in the spot where we warned, in the time frame where we warned it, and USGS choosing not to report the earthquake. Depth, 5 kilometers. So 5 km depth, 3.3 striking in the northeast. Now there's an example of them not reporting an earthquake in a spot where we issued a warning. Rare earthquake, too. We don't get 3.3s up there very much. And we said to watch for 3.0 activity. Why? Because of the 3s that struck in the Midwest. Take a look at it. Past several days, look. 3.0 swarm struck in the Midwest. Now, let's turn off the Canadian feed since it technically interferes with the other feeds here. It's 30 days worth on the Canadian feed. It just puts too many earthquakes on there. So anyways, there we go. Now you can see past several days, look at the Midwest, and look what happened today in the Midwest. A 3.3. So we got a 3.3 in the Midwest. We get a 3.3 up to the Northeast. And guess what? The 3.3 is at a fracking operation. Anybody shocked? But it's not just anywhere. It's in Kansas. So it's the first 3.0 to strike in Kansas in a while, and we issued a warning between Oklahoma and Wyoming, and we specifically named out Kansas, did we not? Yes, we did. I'm not bragging, just got to tell you. So here's Kansas with a 3.3 earthquake. Let's just go look it up and see what's there. I already know what's there, but if you're a new viewer, you'll be able to see what's going down. So zooming in on the area, here we are. And now we have a 4.3 from June of 2015, 2 years ago, earthquake striking here. And right across a few farmers' fields, we have our fracking operation, where they are drilled down into the crust and are injecting water, wastewater as they call it, but it's really just chemical-laden water that fractures the crust and then releases gas and oil up through the water, and they just kind of siphon it off the top, pump it off the top under pressure, and sell it on the market. So it's a big pumping operation, and it's being struck by a 3.3 on the same day that a 3.3 strikes up in Lake Ontario. Now, going over to the west, you're going to see new activity has developed out where? Well, back in Montana, 3.0 activity carrying on, and then down in Southern California, going right across, almost equidistantly spaced, all the same size earthquakes. But now we need to turn on the smaller earthquake feed. It'll show us all the microquakes that are, again, happening. Now, the microquakes just let us know what's coming overall. They add up together into a cumulative total. And what you'll notice here is several of the locations we've talked about over the past couple weeks are now swarming, including Mammoth Mountain, including the nuclear test sites. This is a nuke test site near Baden, Nevada, that's swarming out, guys, at a 12-kilometer depth. Now, they're not doing underground nuke tests there, but the reason a swarm is happening there is because California and Nevada absorb the pressure like a sponge. And then the pressure seeks the path of least resistance, as evidenced by the new studies put out this week that confirmed everything that I've ever told you. Now, in case you guys don't know, here's the nuclear test sites right here. These are all craters, and then you can turn on the Google Earth community to see the information on each test. And it'll give you the kiloton, the date, all right? So 67, 1 kiloton, April 7th. Some of these are really big tests. 89 kiloton, October 14th, 1970, that big crater there. Okay, so this whole thing, and it goes over to the west. That's not the only spot. These are nuke test sites here too. So over here, UK, it was a UK test? Really? How is that? UK, Praetorian, Gibney. We let the UK do test here? Serious? Wow, that's wild. I didn't know that. Anyways, we got an earthquake striking right next to there, and the crust is fractured due to humans detonating underground nuclear tests there over and over again. And that's not the only spot. It spreads out all the way across there. Going down to the south, we have Volcano Peak swarming out. So we're here at the Coso Volcanic Field at Volcano Peak, getting the coordinates, 1 kilometer depth, really shallow. But when you see what's there, I think it's going to make a little bit more sense what's going on. And we'll get into the northwest in a second here, guys. But first, I just want to show you what's going on here in California. So here we are, zooming in on the location. And what you'll see here is a Smithsonian mark for the Coso Volcanic Field, which you're welcome to pause it and read it. And right here in the Coso Field, they have a place called Devil's Kitchen. There we go. Here's the name for it. Devil's Kitchen. And drilled into the crust, they have now steaming off large volumes of water to turn these turbines. But they've drilled into the upper reaches of the magma field, the greater volcanic field there. And that's Volcano Peak. These are lava flows, in case you didn't know. So those are, again, black obsidian and igneous rock. So, going down further to the south, you're going to notice a segregated cluster of earthquakes now around Salton Sea, going on the San Andreas, south tip of the San Andreas. This is actually starting to calm down from where we were, believe it or not. So the previous round of activity has pushed all the way across the Midwest and over to the East Coast, and the only player here for the Midwest is the swarm up in Montana. West Coast, look, it already got hit. 3.7, new swarms, going up to threes, then going over to the Midwest. But there's something else going on we have to talk about here. And that's what's happening up in the Northwest with the slow slip and with the other microquakes that are happening today, which I think we should go look up. Now, people were contacting me about Yellowstone. Let's quickly get this checked off the list. About some harmonic-looking tremors showing up on the Yellowstone charts. Guys, I think they've got the seismic truck deployed, where they do this every year at the summertime, since there's no snow on the upper roads at Yellowstone, and they take the seismic testing truck all around there, and they do these measurements on the magma chamber with earth-penetrating tomography. So that's really interesting, but don't be alarmed if you see kind of equidistantly spaced tremors on the map that are exactly equal in size. The chances of those being natural are, well, pretty much non-existent, you know, for them all to be the same size. That's how you know it's the truck. Okay, so just zooming in on the area, look at this. Okay, we've got a swarm of earthquakes, microquakes, happening right here west of the, what is this? Sand Mountain Field? I've never heard of it. Sand Mountain Volcanic Field consists of a group of 23 basaltic and basaltic andesite cinder cones. Look at these lava flows. That's crazy. I didn't know. Look at that. This is a volcano. Belknap. There we go. And these are lava flows going out into the wilderness. Look at that. With some trees growing in there. I bet that would be a heck of a hike. Look at how big that is. Okay, so those are all lava flows. Lava flows, lava flows, lava flows going over to the west. We always look within 40 miles. That's definitely close enough. Definitely close enough. But there's something else going on here. So there's other earthquakes that we have to take into account. Going up to the north, for instance, up in Washington. See this? Okay, let's just get the coordinates on this. 32 kilometers northeast of Amboy, Washington. What's around Amboy, Washington? Anybody know? Anybody curious? You want to go see? Let's go look. Let's look together, shall we? Ah, here we go. Right on. Okay, so it's not Amboy that we're really looking at, guys. We are actually looking at Mount St. Helens. Here is Mount St. Helens. And right on the flanks of Mount St. Helens, we have our earthquake. So we have a little swarm happening there, little tiny quakes. Again, you can see St. Helens where it's done past flows and just amazing, right? And it blew out to the pass to the north. Well, now we're on the south tip of here, down near in between Marble Mountain, which on the flanks of St. Helens, there are smaller buttes that have formed in the past, but they're covered in trees. They're not going to erupt. We're not worried about an eruption, guys. So let's go up to the north. What's right here? Packwood, Washington. Interesting. I've never heard of the location in particular, but we've got a swarm of earthquakes happening there. Let's just go see what's there. There might not be anything there. I don't know. Oh, Packwood. Well, it's not Packwood. Let's be honest. I mean, what's the standout feature here? Is it Packwood? Should we calculate our distance based upon Packwood? Or should we calculate our distance upon how many feet we are off of the flanks of Mount Rainier? So we have a new swarm happening at Mount Rainier. All right. Well, now that means Mount St. Helens and Mount Rainier both have earthquake activity of significant size in the past 24 hours. Here, to the north. In the center, we have a volcanic activity right here. And then down to the south. We can go look these up if you don't trust me, which I know there's some people who don't. You know what? Let's just go pull the coordinates. Portola, California. I'm just going to prove a case to you here. All these swarms aren't just happening randomly. Where are we zooming in on? We are zooming in on the buttes right next to a greater volcanic field on the other side of the lake, but we're within just a few miles of the Buttes and Sugarloaf Volcanic Butte. The Buttes Butte. Creatively named. You can see the tuftage on top of here, I guess, but this is ancient. I mean, that's like undersea ancient. It was formed so long ago. Maybe not that long ago, but definitely undersea formation on, you know, some of these. You know, that's how old they are. So when there was water in here a long time ago. So it's no accident. These are falling next to the volcanoes. Then you get down to the south. You might say, well, what about Lake Tahoe? There's one right in the middle of Lake Tahoe. Well, from what I understand, Lake Tahoe has a record amount of water in it right now, or maybe not a record, but it's almost all full. That's just something that came to me recently in the past couple of weeks. So if that's the case, it would make sense that there would be small earthquakes striking inside of the center of Lake Tahoe, the dead center, right? The total water weight pressing down on the top of there. But then you can just get past there and you go down to the south. And this is Mammoth Mountain, which is a known volcano down to the south. So really, pretty much all the activity we're seeing in the north, central, and eastern parts of California, all happening at volcanic locations or very close to them, just with just a few exceptions. Then in the western part of California, it's strictly fault zone, going down from the South Hayward Fault into the North San Andreas, skipping across LA completely, silent zone in LA, which we'll talk about in a second, And that's the activity that's going on earthquake-wise. But now we have to consult something else. We have to consult the tremor map. Now, the tremor map shows us earthquakes, quote-unquote, that are smaller than microquakes. These are associated with the plate moving side by side. And as the plates butt up against one another and pressure comes in, you then see these tremors, which are, again, smaller than microquakes, that are happening across the region. Now, looking at the last 24 hours, I want you to compare that to 48 hours. 48 hours, we saw a cluster down to the south with just a spattering going up to the north. Now, in the last 24 hours, look what's going on. The cluster to the south is almost completely stopped, and we have a new cluster starting to develop up here to the north on Vancouver Island and at the Oregon-Washington border. So again, the swarm down to the south was hundreds of events last week. That stopped and has now shifted slightly to the north, it looks like, and a new swarm is starting to pick up to the north. So this means that event, the slow slip that they said stopped, I mean, if it stopped, what are we looking at? I mean, if it stopped, why is the corresponding location on land moving? What corresponding location on land? We're talking about the corresponding location to the out-to-sea fracture zone, the Juan de Fuca, here. So the Juan de Fuca fracture zone going up into North Vancouver Island and all the way down south to the Mendocino Ridge and the Gorda Escarpment. And we just had a 3.7, 4.0 type earthquake a day and a half ago here at Eureka. And that means that the spot in between, these spots here, are under pressure. Now, we've been talking about it for months at this time. And the other earthquakes that we look for tend to strike fours and fives. However, looking at this, it's a little bit different. Right now, the slow slip is still carrying on. And if the slow slip is still carrying on, that means, again, we need to watch every day until the slow slip finally stops. And I mean stops for a couple days. It's going to have to go quiet. Once it goes quiet, then I'm looking for the potential of an earthquake above 7.7. I've set a threshold at 7.7 based upon past events. So past events, 2012, 2013, 2014, 2015. Let's use 2015 as a good example. 2015, there was a smaller slow slip happening out here near the axial seamount. That resulted in a new eruption at the axial seamount and a 6.0 earthquake. Right at the tip, at the cleft segment. A 6 and a swarm of 4s. Okay, it was a smaller slow slip, went on for a shorter period of time, caused a 6 out to sea. Go back to 2012. Vancouver Island moved. It was a bigger event. Went on for longer. Went on for 6 weeks or so and had hundreds if not thousands of events in 2012. Then it was followed up by a 7.7 on the north tip of it. We can go back to 2012, 2013 when fives and upper fives resulted and near 6. I think going up to 6.5. I mean, each event was followed by a larger earthquake in the middle of the event, in the middle of the area that was struck. So here we are, and we're watching for it to happen. If nothing happens, of course, we will get on after the slow slip stops, finally, and we'll talk about it, and if nothing hits, we will cancel the warning for the area, or the watch. Let's call it a watch instead of a warning, because there is a difference. A watch is something we're watching out for, but we don't know a time frame to give you. A warning is when we can actually give you a time frame, usually within a few days or less. So two things going on right now. It appears that the West Coast is due again in the north-northwest up by Vancouver Island with a new earthquake. Since the 4 hit to the south, this means the north part is primed. Bogoslav has stopped erupting, and that leads me into the volcanic eruption feed. So we see a report on Bogoslav on the list for today saying no new blast at Bogoslav. So here we go. No eruption. Yesterday, there were eruptions. Today, there are none. Instead, we're seeing a replacement over to the west at the Kamchatka Peninsula at Kariemsky volcano. Okay, so Kariemsky blowing over and over again, replacing all the others. Do you see Shivalush on there? Right? How about Shivalush? Yeah, Shivalush is gone. Kluchevskoy last night, going into this morning. So Kluchevskoy, one eruption, Shivalush gone, replaced entirely by Kariemsky up to the north. Well, let's show you where these are. Bogoslav is right here. Kariemsky is right here in the Kamchatka Peninsula. And Shivalush and Kluchevskoy are right next to each other, right here where the letter V is. So we have two new blasts up here to the north. That's it. That's a huge change from where we were. So it means that where there were blasts, there should now be new earthquake activity. So next to Bogoslav, for instance, we have to warn the Aleutian Island chain. How big? Well, at least 2 to 3 blasts. That'll put us in the 5 range. 5 to 5.5, and that's not taking into account the deep earthquake over here. You take into account the deep earthquake over here that could be causing a 6 to 7 in the Kuril Islands, that'll shake things up for Alaska in the next few days if that happens. So two things going on. One, volcanic eruptions stopping up to the north. We'll have to watch and wait to see if that increases. Now over to the west, going across in the West Pacific, we have to watch out for, again, like I said, around Japan, this activity is going to get bigger since a new deep 5 has happened. Now this is significant, guys. The deep earthquake event is carrying on. There is no doubt about it. Take a look at the last several days' worth of earthquakes. Again, reported by the EMSC and USGS. You can see it. So the deep earthquake, stand high off the globe. We are in a deep earthquake event. I don't have a full tally count on it, but I can just tell you, I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, I see 12, and that might be not even counting if there's others that are missed. So in the past few days, 12 new deep events. 12 deep events means shallower, larger movement is coming in between our deep earthquakes. Now let me explain to you how to do this in case you don't know. The way we are able to determine the magnitudes that strike and the locations, you look at the last 48 hours worth of earthquakes, and you find your silent zones next to the earthquakes that are currently happening. Sometimes there's multiple silent zones, other times there's just a few. In this case, we have a good silent zone we can point out to you here as a great example, next to our deep earthquakes raised high off the globe. That brings us right in here. You find the middle point, what I call the fulcrum point of the silent zone, for the movement to occur, and you add up the earthquakes on both sides. In this case, a deep earthquake like this, a deep 4.7, can cause a shallow 5.7 up to 6.7. So between that magnitude spread, you watch in the middle here, and you can see the middle point between the two earthquakes. I don't even have to point it out to you. I'll zoom in and out on it a couple times. All right, we're at the triangular bend at the Solomon Islands in Tuvanuatu near New Caledonia. Okay, so that's just one example. Going over to the west, I already used Japan as an example. We talked about the coast of Japan to the south and the Kuril Islands to the north, and we said both are going to be hit. It's not a 50-50 flip. Both will be hit. Another example would be over here in Asia. See this 5.3 here at Mount Sinabung in western Sumatra, and you see the 4.1 here. Well, we watch between the 4.1 and the 5.3, and look, that's where the previous earthquake struck. I mean, that's pretty obvious, but we'll get hit again. Now, it should be a little less than the 5.3. As pressure transfers up and around, this is a shallower earthquake. This is not a deep earthquake. So it's going to lose a couple points coming up and around. That would put us at an upper 4, 4.9, 4.8, in that range, striking at the bend in the next few days. And then going across over to the west even further. I mean, it's not going to stop there. Here's another example of a silent point. Iran going into Afghanistan, Pakistan. See the 4.1 here and a 4.5 here. Watch for a combined total, which is a 4.6, to occur in the middle point. Now you see our red arrows. We'd watch along the red arrows. Okay? I mean, it's just a perfect example. Then we get back over to Europe. Now let's talk about this. If you're in Italy, if you're in anywhere in South Europe, I want you to listen. You have to watch to your east. You have to watch Macedonia, Greece, Turkey, Iran. If you watch those locations, you'll see what's coming your way. And you already had 4.0 earthquakes coming your way yesterday. Now, where did they go? There was a new 4 yesterday in Crete. What's going on in Italy now? Let's turn on the INGV last 150 earthquakes and look at the smaller events. So you're going to see something here. Let's wait for it. Okay, here we go. Last 150 events. Obviously, we've got a stack of earthquakes here right at the center, but they're all in the 0, 1, and 2.0 range. Okay, so this new swarm happening here. Hold on. We've got a new swarm that's just popping on the feeds right now in... No? Yeah. Right here, new swarm popping on right now in the last several hours in the 0, 1, and near 2.0 range. But it's just below 2, so the EMSC is not going to be getting that on their feed. So you guys, it looks like nothing's happening in Italy right now if you're consulting the USGS or EMSC feed. Guess you have to consult the ING feed to see these. But the dates on them, I can click, you can see. Here's the coordinates, and I mean, I can open up any one of them if you want to take a look. Obviously, just randomly selecting one here, you'll be able to see. So, I mean, I don't have time to open up every earthquake and prove to you that I'm, you know, not faking earthquakes here. You just, again, you can download a copy of Earthquake 3D and check for yourself if you're curious. So, new swarm is happening there, but its magnitude is low. Frequency, number of earthquakes, is picking up. We told you this would happen yesterday. We said first the frequency would pick up, the number of events. Then the magnitude would go up, and we would start to see new activity topping out near 4. Well, we're not there yet. We're on day 1 of this. Yesterday was Crete. So yesterday was Crete. We have to wait a day, maybe 2 days, 48 hours usually. And we're day 1 into it. So watch out. It's going to happen again. There's no doubt about it. The fact that you've got other pressure going up and around Macedonia, going up into Czech Republic at Germany's border, and we have to also say this could be mining of some kind, right? I mean, it's next to a strip mine. So, overall, I want you to be prepared for a 4.0 to strike in Italy, central Italy, within the next day and a half, just in case. That's what you should watch for. Secondly, this new activity that's coming in. Guys, yesterday there was all this 4.0 activity we talked about, and we told you it was going to be coming into Italy, or I'm sorry, into Macedonia. Macedonia should get hit again. It should, and it should go up to 5.0. So I want you to be prepared for it right now. Don't let your guard down. Just because Czech Republic's being hit, that's a result of the previous earthquakes coming across. So you still have to deal with this new round of pressure we talked about yesterday, which showed up here and here. Let me highlight it. Boop. Here and here. So that new pressure showed up here and here. Now where is it going to go? It's going to go to the further west-northwest. And it'll all happen in the next couple days. So luckily, we're only talking 4.0 range earthquakes right now. And that leads me back around the plate. Everywhere else that we're talking about the potential of a large activity occurring in the next few days. So I would like to point out to you that this 6.3 here now marks the third or fourth 6.0 earthquake that's been reported. So 6.5 or 6.8 was reported here in the Philippines. The day before that, or 2 days before that, a 6.9 was reported here that they deleted. Then a 6.8, 6.9 struck here as well. Oh, one more. A 7.1 was reported in the Arctic Circle that they deleted as well. So, look, if we drop the ones that they deleted, that's still two 6.8s or 6.5s striking within a few days of each other. If we don't drop the ones, then this week that means four 7.0 type earthquakes, basically. That's what it means. So it would be a dramatic increase. Oh, and the largest earthquake in 40 years in the Intermountain West in the United States, near 6.0 on the north part of the magma chamber of Yellowstone. So it's, again, I'll leave it up to you to decide whether or not you want to believe that all these earthquakes that are happening are mistakes that are being deleted over and over again in the spots where we're issuing warnings for. I don't believe that. Now, you probably know why I don't believe that. If it was just some random event and I wasn't getting attacked by the professionals who work for these agencies, then I might think it was just, you know, me being able to forecast mistakes or something. But in this case, we have active people working for the industry, in the industry, who are publicly coming against what I'm doing. Now, I do have to address this because my name and my moderators and people in here and 16-year-old MC Player has been involved with this now. They brought him into it. Look, guys, look, I am not MC Player. MC Player is a teenager. All right? MC Player is not a hacker. No one's hacking the USGS feeds or any feeds to put on earthquakes. If you're accusing me of falsifying earthquakes, I challenge you to prove that. And don't tell me that you can't download a copy of Earthquake 3D. Secondly, if you're going to make the accusation that I'm falsifying earthquakes, and then, of course, you can't back that up because it's not true, then that calls all of what you're saying into question. Everything. So if you say I fake earthquakes, which I don't, then you've lost the debate before it ever began. And that's all I'm going to say on the matter. So we're not adding earthquakes. You can download a copy of Earthquake 3D yourself and keep track yourself. You can see the same readout that I have here now. Okay? And all that being said, I want you to have an earthquake plan and be prepared just in case. Now, if you live in some of these areas, like let's say you live in up in Minnesota or the Dakotas, well, it would be a good idea for you to maybe think about what you would do when an earthquake hits, but you don't need to have those plans like somebody down in, let's say, Oklahoma or over on the West Coast. I think that's just prudent to be prepared in those areas and to know what's coming your way. And to, again, look at the rest of the planet and see what's happening. So you start seeing sixes and sevens, near sevens, pop off. You start seeing multiple deep earthquakes. What'll really spell it out for you, I think, is when Japan gets hit again. When Japan gets hit at both zones on the coast of Honshu and the Kuril Islands in the next few days, I think you're going to be, again, your eyes will be opened if you are currently have them closed. And we hope that it stays under 7. We hope that it's under 2 magnitudes larger. These deep earthquakes can cause up to 2 magnitudes larger. So that means 6.0 to 7.0 is potential. But I always hope for less. I mean, I hope that nothing happens and that we have to come on and say nothing hit. That's what I hope for. But hope in science? Nah. I would encourage you to always have hope, but don't base your life decisions on the hope in science that something might not happen. Right? It's better to err on the side of caution and to be prepared for something that could happen instead of trying to say nothing will ever happen, right? Anyways, so what time is it now? It is 4:42 p.m. Central Time. I'm going to stop recording now, and we will save this as a video over on my YouTube channel. One more time, I'm going to tell you guys, if you're down in New Zealand, you got off somewhat lucky with the south part of the island being hit, but now you've got a new round of fours coming in, which are hitting now. Which means the north part of the island, I said this last night, but I'll say it again. North part of the island, from the Catcher's Mitt to the Arrow, is going to be hit. Now, you hope it's going to be under 6.4, 6.5, but it could go as high as that. These deep earthquakes up to your north. So take a look at it one more time. I don't want to have to spell this out too many times for the people in New Zealand, but look what's on both sides of New Zealand. See the 5.6 to your north and the 5.2 to your south in red? Those struck first, okay? And in the middle here, we have a 6.6 and a 4.3. So really, you've been pushed up on the underside of New Zealand, and your plate boundary has just fractured offshore down to the south. Kind of like a repeat of what happened at Kiakura, guys. So that 7.0 earthquake that struck at Kiakura last year in the summertime has just now occurred down here. Now, the only question is this going to swarm out like it did previously? The answer, I think, is no. The previous plate boundary fracture is too close. So, in other words, this spot's going to still swarm, even though the plate boundary just fractured to the south of the island. I think it's pretty obvious. And go back to last summer, and the north part got hit here at the Catcher's Mitt position with a 7.0 earthquake as well. The day Animatronic landed down there to go down there for vacation, the guy who made my graphics for all my intros and stuff, he flew down there the day he landed. A 7.0 earthquake hit here on the North Island. So you've gotten 3 7.0 type earthquakes in the last year across New Zealand. North first, central second, now south third. Progression in a year's time from the Catcher's Mitt to the center down to the south. I think it's pretty obvious now. Okay? And that's all I got for you. Much love to everybody, and thank you to all the people who have supported my operation and sharing the information. I am 100% positive you've made a difference in getting people at least prepared and maybe possibly even averting injury. When the earthquake hit over in Italy, we issued a warning the day before. In Italy, a deep 5.8 happened over here in the Tyrrhenian Sea, about 500-something kilometers down, a deep 5.8. We got on, issued a warning for a 6.8 to 7.8 earthquake to strike here in central Italy. The next day, that earthquake hit the 7.0. It was the largest in many years' time.
Now, again, the people had a 24-hour warning. They got the warning. I'm positive they did because they took to the news the next day to thank us for putting the warning out and letting them know to watch for it. And they slept by the doors and warned the mayor of the town to be prepared. And that was all said on BBC News in case you missed it. So word up to my people and much love.